Hello everybody and welcome back to another Manga Thoughts and Opinions video. This is being recorded at 5 in the morning on the 9th of November 2022, just in case this upload actually gets delayed. Now we'll be talking about a book that I read yesterday. I started reading it yesterday morning and then I ended up taking a nap, woke up, played some stuff with some people, and then ended up taking another nap and then finished the book just prior to midnight. So after finishing Your Name, which is the manga that we read last, I was very eager to move on to another manga, but I was unable to decide. Now, since I've been rendering a lot of videos recently and trying to get stuff uploaded, a good time for me to read is actually when I'm rendering, specifically if I'm rendering a large session of videos where it's going to take a little while before they're finished. But I couldn't decide exactly what to read next. Now, obviously, we're talking about ReZero, so I ended up choosing that. But this was actually chosen by my significant other, who I mentioned to that I was unable to decide, and they just said, why don't you read your ReZero books? So here we are talking about ReZero. And there's actually quite a bit to talk about here before we get started. Since this is the first in what's going to be a long-running coverage of the ReZero series, there's some things to talk about from the past. I'll start off by saying that ReZero was actually one of the first manga that I ever bought back in 2019 when I got my very first haul of manga. Which I think was about 24 books, I believe. A good chunk of those, I think 7 of the books, were actually ReZero. The entire set for Volume 1, or excuse me, for Chapter 1 and Chapter 2, which is 2 volumes for the first chapter and 5 volumes for the second chapter. So these books have been sitting around for a few years, obviously. But we have finally gotten around to starting them. And I was very excited to actually sit down and start reading ReZero, because, obviously, if you have followed my anime thoughts and opinions stuff before, you may already know this, but in case you don't, I have a very high opinion of the anime for ReZero. So if you're coming into this as a novel fan, a light novel fan, or a manga fan, or a TV fan for this series, just note that I started my adventure with ReZero with the anime in 2019 was when I ended up seeing the anime for the first time. And I am pretty sure that the manga was actually released based on the light novel before the anime actually started releasing. Because I think that this book is dated 2014, and the anime I think released in 2016. Correct me if I'm wrong on that, but that's just what I think I ended up looking up yesterday. And I have, as I said, a very high opinion of ReZero. I love the show to death, except maybe Season 2, Part 2, but I have rewatched the show multiple times, and I look forward to rewatching it again. So to be able to relive it in book form was very interesting to me, because I'm always curious to see how things differ between what I saw versus what I'm going to read. And in the future, I have a few manga that I'm gonna read before I watch the anime in question, because I want to see how that feels to go through that transition. Yeah, that's about it. That's about all I can give for the history on my past with ReZero. I'm sure a lot of people want me to look at the ReZero light novels. I do have a few of them, but I've got big gaps. I think I've got volume 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 10. So there's some stuff I gotta fill in there, but I know that the ReZero light novel series is very highly rated. In fact, I think it's higher rated than any of the other ReZero stuff. Higher than the manga, higher than the anime, but I could be wrong on that, I'm not quite sure. Anywho, let's go ahead and take a look at what ReZero Volume 1 of Chapter 1 has to offer. This is a little bit confusing, ReZero starting life in another world. Chapter 1, A Day in the Capital, is actually kind of like the first arc, I guess you could say, in the manga that has 2 total volumes to it. And we're talking about Volume 1 today, obviously. But they're chapters as well. So, for example, Volume 1 has 5 chapters in it. So it's a little bit weird to talk about ReZero, Chapter 1, Chapter 3. You know, it's a bit weird, but they call them episodes, in the at least in the English version of the book, instead of chapters. So you have Episode 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. But this has actually been a bit confusing, not to really me myself, because I write down to try to keep track of this, but even to my parents, who in the past have gotten me ReZero books before, when I asked them for like Christmas and stuff like that. And what I found quite amusing at one point was, in when I had written it down, I had really carefully tried to explain that the title of the book is Chapter 2, Volume so on and so on. This led to them accidentally getting duplicate books without realizing it, because on the cover it says Chapter 1, Chapter 2, but it's in very fine print, so they'll get Volume 2 of Chapter 1 and then Volume 2 of Chapter 2. You see what I mean? But thankfully it's easy to follow when you actually have the books all lined up with each other and in the right order. Now, I had accidentally, mistakenly thought that this was 6 chapters long, the first volume. It's actually only 5. The reason why I got that mistaken was because when you open up the cover and look at the table of contents, it actually has 6 episodes listed, but one of them isn't actually numbered. You have the five first chapters, and then the 6th one is actually the afterword. So I got really confused when I finished the book and I got to the afterword chapter and it was 1 page. And I was like, whoa, what? There's no way there's a 1 page chapter in here. Is something wrong? And then I finally looked and saw that it's not numbered. So I'm assuming we don't count afterword as an actual standalone chapter here. Analyst says that volume 1 and 2 only has 11 total chapters throughout chapter 1 of A Day in the Capital, which would mean that this one has the 5 chapters, and then the next book lists 6 chapters in its table of contents. So hopefully I did that one correctly, otherwise I'm tracking this on Analyst wrong at the moment. I might have to ask around. So let's get some of the usual stuff out of the way for this particular arc. I won't cover this stuff down the road until we get to like other arcs or other ReZero works and stuff. But this is a manga that, like I said, is 2 volumes in total. That is 11 chapters overall for the first arc, A Day in the Capital, which started releasing on the 27th of January, 2014, and released up through the February 27th of 2015, which is really weird to think about because that's over a year it took to get the second book out. Boy, would it suck having to wait for these to come out. It's hard enough waiting a week for a new anime episode to come out, let alone fucking over a year or years for a new book to come out. Looking at you, Toradora. But it is listed on Analyst as an action-adventure, comedy, drama, romance, fantasy. And as I've explained a lot in the ReZero series, anime series, most of these make total sense. They all have their own place and role to play in the show itself. The comedy is actually pretty downplayed, mainly because there's a lot of violence in ReZero, and I've been very appreciative of the fact that the comedy never gets in the way of the drama. In the past, I've explained that I have a very touchy relationship with comedy in anime, and the reason why it's so touchy a lot of the times is because not only do I find the comedy to sometimes just be not funny, but that's just a subjective thing, but I never liked it when you would have a show that wants you to take something seriously, and then they throw some stupid joke in there. That ruins any of the tension that I thought I might have had in that moment. ReZero doesn't really do that ever. When shit gets real in this, it gets real. And when shit's not real, the characters might have some joke to go around. Subaru basically being his own comedic relief, but he's also a really lovable character, and I'll get to why I like Subaru in a little bit. So you never have a character who gets their head cut off and then, like, their head rolls around on the floor and then tells a joke as it's rolling around. No, when someone gets their head cut off, they're fucking dead, okay? And there's nobody standing around looking and being like, ha, lol, did you see the way it rolled? So funny. You know, we don't have any of that garbage here, thankfully. So thankfully, the comedy doesn't get in the way for me. But fantasy, the series takes place in a almost medieval, high fantasy style world. You've got various types of creatures, magic, type of things going on. So if you like that kind of story, you're here. Now, it is an isekai anime, and I'm trying to think back because I don't think I had really seen too many isekai anime when I sat down to watch ReZero. In fact, I remember being very blown away by ReZero because it was actually not what I thought it would be. For whatever reason, I could be wrong on what I remember, but I definitely explained this in my anime thoughts and opinions video. But I think I remember thinking that ReZero was like one of those isekai anime where it's like the character goes in and then it's a harem, you know, and then just end of story. I had no idea it was about a character that's in a death loop or a character that, you know, has witnesses and partakes in death. I never thought that that was anything to do with this. And it makes total sense. ReZero, restarting from zero. So never put that together in my brain back in the day, and I'm so happy that I was brought into this series because god fucking damn is it one of my favorite shows as far as the anime that I've watched so far. It's not my favorite, but it is definitely up there. I would have to go and say that this is probably in my top five. If I really broke it down, it might even be in my top three, but I'd really have to sit and think about that. And that's saying a lot, because trust me, there's a shitload of good anime out there. So to put up in the top five, goddamn. Anyways, I'm trailing off. So at least for this arc, and I assume that this is going to carry on, we have the art being done by Daichi. Now the artwork, I'll talk about the artwork in a moment. The original story by Tape? I'm not very good with these Japanese names. Nagatsuki. And then the character design, specifically, being by Shinichiro Otsuka, I guess. I guess the character design and the artwork go hand in hand here. I'm not used to seeing a separate artist and character designer, so I don't really know the story behind that, but just to mention this, you have to remember that because I was into this from the anime first, that means that I'm coming into it with the perspective of the anime viewer, but fully open to seeing what kind of story that the books are going to tell. But to come into this, I feel very familiar with it. Even though the anime came out later, both of these have a very similar style to them. These characters look like I pulled them off of the anime screen, off of the screen when I was watching the anime, and just stuck them in a book. They do look very much alike. Maybe not exact, I'd say maybe the one that looks so far the most different is probably Amelia, but that's not saying much because she still looks very similar. I can look at her and say, that's Amelia. You know, I don't even have to see her outfit, you just have to see her face. But that's probably the only one that I would say is the most different. As far as the artwork is concerned, I think it looks fucking great. You know, I mean, I haven't read a lot of manga yet, so I don't have a lot to compare it to, so it's much more difficult for me to say that something looks good because it might actually look really crappy, you know, compared to some other manga out there. And I can say compared to what I have read so far, there are, for example, some of the Higurashi arcs, because what was unique about Higurashi was each arc was actually drawn by a different artist. So the style stays relatively the same. You can always tell who's who, the theme or whatever of characters and the way that they're drawn, but the style is always a little bit different because it's a different artist. And there were some there that I thought looked good, but compared to ReZero, which is a more formed and I would say nice looking art style, I'd probably put this up there as one of the better looking manga that I've read so far as the character design is concerned. And the detail in some of the street scenes and stuff, which is nice. And I'm trying to think if there's anything else that I wanted to mention about that. No, I don't think so. So again, just as a fair warning, we'll go ahead and start going over each of the chapters here. I have been coming into this from the anime, so when I compare this to the anime, I'm not going to like bring ReZero's manga down any just because I thought the anime did something better. I wouldn't consider that too fair in this case, but just keep in mind I'm probably going to talk about them that way because that's why I like ReZero, because of the anime. So let's go ahead and take a look. So we got chapters one. Okay, that says, yeah, okay. Now I like that these are actually named, unlike in Your Name, which was chapter one episode 1, chapter 2, episode 2, chapter 3, episode 3, etc. Here we actually have names for the chapters. So we'll begin right off with chapter 1, episode 1, which is, "And God said, don't get ahead of yourself." So we start off almost exactly where ReZero starts off in the television anime. And at first, I actually wasn't too big a fan of how this book opened, because, again, I came into it with all of my expectations from the anime. But they do actually explain it away in the second chapter. So in the anime, it actually starts off, you know, with Subaru going into the convenience store. We get to know a little bit about his life, his room, his whatever, you know, whatever he gets up to. But not too much is given to us, and then suddenly, pop, he's in the world of ReZero, right? Well, here, it opens on the first page in the world of ReZero already. We're already there. We don't get any convenience store or anything, and it barely even so much as mentions anything about a convenience store until, like I said, the beginning of the next chapter. So they just simply left it out until a little bit later. Which is why I said that the pacing of the opening is different to the anime. But here's one thing. This is the only complaint I actually have with this book. And it's the only complaint. And it's in comparison to the anime, which I thought did it a little bit better. And that's that the pacing of the opening, in terms of the entire opening, not just when he appears here on the street, Market Street, but from the moment that we begin the first chapter, you turn like a couple pages and we've gone from the Market Street into the alleyway into our first encounter with Emilia. Like, it happens in the blink of an eye, as opposed to across an entire episode in the show. But I kind of have come to expect that manga, at least from my experience with the Higurashi manga, I've come to expect that manga goes by a lot faster than the show does. Clearly, it doesn't take you 20 minutes to read a single page like it would to watch an episode, but sometimes it just feels weird. Like, in the anime, I might spend 20 minutes getting from point A to B, but in the book, I turn a page and we're already to point C, you know what I mean? And I guess it's not really a complaint so much as it is, I guess I just need to adjust to this new type of experience when going through. I mean, when I finished this book, I'm surprised how far into the opening of the show we already are, just after finishing the first volume. But again, I guess I should be used to it, because the Higurashi books were the same way, and I guess some of the other manga I've read were the same way. So I guess it's just manga in general is like that. I'm assuming maybe the light novel type of situation will take things a lot slower. But then again, I don't know, because light novels are very small. They're called light novels, after all. So I guess I'll just have to wait and see. But either way, basically, we have this character, Subaru, who comes from our place, Earth, and he's found himself in this high fantasy-like world. No explanation given to him or us, the viewer, which is fine. If the character doesn't know, we don't have to know either, because then we're in the same position as this kid. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Subaru's character a little later, but it's going to kind of touch on spoiler stuff from down the road. But after basically turning down an apple in this, but it's basically an apple, because he's flat broke and doesn't have money that works in this world. Instead, doesn't he have money on him though? Yeah, he has money, but it's yen from Earth, from Japan. It's not, I don't think that's going to fly here in a place where we use gold crowns and pieces. But he sets off, and I'm trying to remember exactly what leads him into the alleyway, but he ends up finding himself in an alleyway where he gets jumped by thugs who want to steal him of all of his shit. But obviously he stands up to this, because from his point of view, he's seeing himself in almost like a fourth wall type of situation. He sees himself in another world because he's been isekai'd away, so he probably is the powerful main character that has some overpowered ability. Which it's kind of like it's parodying itself at this point. And I like this, because one of the aspects that I have a bit of an issue with isekai anime is the fact that the main character is always so powerful, or is always the center of everything, the center of the world, right? Now, if you enjoy that kind of thing, that's totally fine, right? And I can enjoy it too. Like I've said before, in terms of cliches and stuff, I don't care if something's a cliche as long as I enjoy it. As long as it's done well, I don't mind if it's done. I just don't really enjoy these isekai stories where the character is the center of everything and ends up either obtaining so many fucking powers that they can just use in any situation they want to, or they're so powerful that there really is no point in there being many fights or battles or anything, because I know the main character is just going to walk out unscathed, which is what ReZero caught me off guard with, because technically Subaru does have a very potent power at his disposal, but it's not what you think. His ability is the fact that he can, not necessarily on his own hand, mind you, turn back time by dying. So he resets to, I guess what he calls, if I remember correctly from the anime, checkpoints, where when he dies, he is set back to a certain position, and the world itself is reset. Nobody has any of this memory, only he carries the memory over, which means it's already getting rid of one of the issues I have with quote-unquote reincarnation or time reversal, which is where people lose their memories or forget. Subaru gets to keep all that shit. And this is one thing that also makes me really happy with Subaru's character. He's not the center of everything. Not only is his power incredibly just mentally devastating for Subaru, no, he's not the center of the world. He doesn't collect a whole bunch of characters that become his battle group. Instead, there's a whole fucking load of shit going on in this world. There's politics going on. Nobody's coming out of their way for Subaru. He just bumps into Amelia for the first time, which happens to work out, obviously. You know, when he goes to the mansion later, he's, again, not the center of everything. Hell, when he's one place, people are dying in a completely different part of the world. You know, main characters and stuff. So that's another aspect that I really like about him. What I also fucking love is the fact that he gives a shit, you know? He's not annoying in the sense of a lot of main characters that we have to deal with in a lot of these types of stories, you know, where they're very high on themselves and they're very... I guess that's all that's on my mind, is that they're always so stuck on themselves, right? And Subaru is always joking about himself and how shit he is at everything, yet he can really throw a punch if he needs to. And I love that aspect. He's a total runt, but at the same time, he has muscle behind him. As he explains himself, when you have nothing better to do and you swing a sword around all day, you get a swing going. But I just like that Subaru isn't this overpowered character that everyone sticks to just because, and that he's annoying at the same time. Instead, he's out there getting himself killed, which he suffers from in the anime, and I'm sure we're going to see that here in the manga too. You feel the frustration that he feels when you repeat the same scenario, and you because the frustration that comes with repeating a scenario isn't just that, you know, oh fuck, I fucked it up and failed, I gotta try again. It's the frustration of, what about all that shit I went through to get to that point? It has been completely erased, and now I have to do it again. I have to convince people, or I have to figure out how to keep this situation from happening, or, you know, you have this really heartwarming moment with a character that you might fall in love with, and now it's been erased, and that doesn't exist to them anymore, but it still exists to you. You know, etc., right? And that's what makes, in my opinion, his quote-unquote overpowered ability really intriguing to me, because he's getting fucked up to use this ability. You know, he's not winning every scenario just because he's powerful, unlike having, let's say, some sort of strength that could obliterate an opponent. He instead has an ability that allows him to try to get the outcome he wants, which means that in the end, you would hope that the end of an arc or the end of a scenario will end happy, in quotations. But he has to go through so much fucking shit and agony each time, you know, just to just to get through one of these situations, he might have to die four times and try four different times. And then something else happens down the road. And it's super intriguing to me to read, in this case, or in the case of the anime, watch, because I never know what the fuck is going to happen next, you know? Sure, I'm watching him go through the same scenario a couple different times, but I get to watch and try to figure out, just like him, how do we take it this time? Okay, we know this is going to happen, and I've already tried this, and that didn't work, so I got to try to figure out, how do I get around that? Why the fuck is no one listening to me? I'm going to have a breakdown because I've been dying over and over, and nobody knows that, nor can I tell anybody. You see what I mean? He has to put up with so much bullshit, and yet he always basically puts everyone else ahead of himself. He's just a selfless character, but he's totally a horny boy sometimes, you know? And that's another thing. I don't get to, despite him being fully aware that he's in love with one of these characters, I don't see him lifting up the skirt of the maids to look at their panties while they're talking about sacrificing themselves. I don't get to see that because he's not a total fucking cock. That's why I really enjoy Subaru as a character in ReZero, and it's super rare for me to like a male lead in one of these types of stories. But they fucking did it. The writer did it. So, fucking yes, you know? We're up to almost 30 minutes here on the first video, because I've been rambling on about how much I really enjoy ReZero and how much I enjoy Subaru. And that's another thing, the other characters are the same way. There isn't a character I hate in this show, except maybe characters that I love to hate, you know, like antagonists and stuff. It's not like other isekai where there is always some fucking annoying comedic relief bullshit that is actually not funny at all and is just annoying as hell, which makes the entire experience worse, as opposed to making me laugh or feel like, you know, like things are lighthearted or whatever, because that's what comedic relief is there for. It's supposed to take away from the drama so that you can feel at ease for a little while until things get serious again. But if the comedic relief themselves are annoying, all you're doing is adding to frustration. And unfortunately, I have to deal with that all the freaking time. Right off the top of my head, there's no character in ReZero that I hate just because they're annoying or anything. I love every character. All of them are memorable. Their names, their voices. And that's so important to me. Just like with Higurashi, it was so important to me to be able to watch an anime with so many characters and remember the cast, and I can hear their voices in my head. They talk to me. No, but I can recognize their voices. See, when I started watching anime, it wasn't that easy for me because I needed to adapt a lot to all these different types of Japanese voice acting techniques. And so after watching, you know, 20 anime, sometimes I wouldn't recognize people by their voice. I wouldn't recognize characters by their voice. And I would sometimes forget names of characters until I had finished the show or rewatched the show a couple times. But Higurashi and ReZero are probably the two earliest shows I watched where I didn't have that issue. I know their voices, I know their names, I know what their faces look like, and the benefit of me having watched the anime first means I can come into this and I can hear those characters' voices while I read out the scenes. And that's actually very important to me, instead of what usually happens where you come up with your own voices for characters and then watch a visual adaptation and then see that the voices are nothing like what you expected, like SSS Warrior Cat's Blue Star being British, which I was not expecting originally way back in my day when I was tiny and young. But either way, that's a lot of this rambling I'm doing now is in regards to the entire series for ReZero, so you know, I might as well get it out of the way here early, but I can guarantee that the future episodes of covering individual volumes will probably be much shorter and more to the point. But anyways, after coming across these thugs, and when I went off on my tangent about Subaru, he has the Subaru. I don't need to use the American pronunciation for the car, thank you. But after going on my tangent about Subaru, he actually does throw a punch, and it works, but it hurts like hell. That's again another thing, because if they're not too powerful, then the main character is just a weak tit, you know? So I would have expected him to throw a punch the guy in the face, he doesn't move at all, and then his hand cracks or something. Well, no, we don't get that. He actually knocks the guy on his ass, but then he gets jumped by the other two, and he's basically looking like he's going to get killed by these guys. They have a knife. He's getting beat to a bloody pulp. And he's having a great first experience here in this new world of his. This is where we get introduced very briefly to a character that is going to be here for a little bit and then disappear for, like, a long time, and that's the character of Felt. Now, we don't actually learn her name until later on in this book, but she is an adorable little thief, basically, and she's running past in this alleyway. She just leaves the dude behind, leaves Subaru behind, and ignores the thieves, and just, or excuse me, the thieves, she is a thief, ignores the thugs, and just gets out of there. She's obviously, having stolen something, getting away. This is where another character arrives who is incredibly important to the story, and that's the character of Amelia. Now, we don't actually know her name in this particular book, but I know that it's Amelia, so I'm cheating. Though she introduces herself later as Satella, which has a completely different meaning in this story, that Subaru and myself do not know, although it is alluded to that this name has some sort of bearing on it, and that apparently her being a half-elf is bad, though again, not explained in this book yet, and her having silver hair is not a good thing either. Basically, everything that's alluded to with Amelia is that she's bad news, in whatever way. Subaru, and us as the reader, probably aren't going to see it that way, though. But you have to love... I guess that doesn't mind. Never mind. I'll go ahead and skip that for right now. Amelia, who's looking for this thief, ends up getting told by the thugs where the thief ran off to, and Amelia charges off after, leaving Subaru behind. But what's nice is that she stops and turns around to actually face the thugs because they're doing something wrong, and she doesn't want to let that happen. So we can already see that she has a bit of a heart, even though she comes off in this book as being a bit of a wiener. Now, it's been a while since I rewatched the show, so maybe she was this cold when we meet her for the first time in the show. I know she was a bit, like, evasive with Subaru at first, but, I mean, she kind of seems mean in this book when she's addressing Subaru or looking down or turning around, etc. But this scene in the book plays out almost identically to how I remember it in my head from the anime. She turns around and we're again introduced to another important character named Puck, who is a little spirit being, basically a little floating cat that seems to be very close to Amelia and lives inside of a little gemstone that she wears like a necklace. And then we get to see, for the first time, magic of some description being cast, which are like these little ice shards. I don't actually know what it's called. I'm not, as much as I love ReZero, I'm not a super nut on all of the world's lore and stuff. So there's probably a name for whatever she uses and whatever she's actually casting. But we do get to see it, and she puts those thugs in their place. And this is where Subaru basically pledges himself to Amelia to help her find this thief, because he knows what she looks like and whatever. Unfortunately, Amelia doesn't have anything to offer him, so she's basically going to turn him down, but according to Subaru, that's fine, because he just wants to help and return, basically pay her back for saving his ass, you know. And this is where... I'm trying to remember if this is where we get the teaser. Yeah, this is the chapter where we get the teaser. So the chapter basically ends with them setting off together. But the teaser for this is just like how the anime opens as well, which is opening with Subaru in a puddle of blood, seeming to reach out for a character's hand and vowing to save this girl, whoever this person is. Now, of course, once you actually see Amelia, you know that that's the same outfit you see in the teaser, which gives you basically a heads up that this show is going to be a bit brutal. And it's also, but that's again, see, I didn't, when I first watched ReZero, I didn't know that Subaru was going to have some ability to pop back in time. So when you get to see a teaser of two basically main characters, or who you assume to be main characters, dead or dying, then you get to see it happen so soon after the beginning, it kind of catches you off guard. And this gives that same teaser. And also the teaser in the manga is colored. Because I do read my books physically if I can, if I have the ability. Hence why I said when I bought these. I have the book right here with me, next to me. Which I guess I could look at for reference if I needed to. But anywho, let's move on to chapter 2. Which is titled Episode 2, Returning the Lap Pillow's Favor. So, I believe Subaru set off... Or I guess Subaru didn't set off. Yeah, hey, that's right, he passed out. I guess from being beat up so goddamn much. But after being saved, Subaru vows to help Amelia at no extra cost. And there's a bit of some comedic stuff where he feels like he woke up on a lap pillow of Amelia, but it's actually Puck who has enlarged himself. I say himself because I still don't know if Puck is male or female. Voiced by a female, I believe, but addresses Amelia as his daughter, and I would just assume that Puck is a male, but then again, assuming things makes an ass out of you and me, so I don't know. Whatever. Anywho, we get to learn a tiny bit about spirits and lesser spirits who Amelia tries to communicate with. This is where we get the reference to half-elf and Satella, which Puck seems to be a little bit, like, kind of rowdy over Amelia saying such things. But we do get to see a little girl, and this is an adorable scene, by the way, from the anime, and I'm happy that it was just as adorable here. When these two are walking through the city, we get to see a small little girl who seems to have lost her parents, and she's crying. And Amelia tries to comfort her, and this is again where Subaru shows just how kind of caring he is and how good he is at what he does. Again, you would expect in this type of show where Subaru, the main character, the goof who is from another world, would come in and make this little girl cry harder by trying to be funny. Instead, he totally wows her with a very simple and classic coin magic trick, and then gives her the coin and tells her to take care of it. And then she walks off with both Amelia and Subaru, calling Amelia her big sister, and they look kind of like a cute couple together, holding the hands of this little kid, until they find the parents. Again, very, very touching scene as well. And this is where we discover that this is actually the daughter of that market vendor who we saw at the very beginning of the first chapter, who was selling the apple, or the apple, or whatever the fuck it's actually called. This is where we get some info about the thief and slums. This is we put together that the thief, who is from the slums, has to live in the slums, so we should find the slums. The slums, of course, are going to be in a certain part of the city, if you just put two and two together, which is exactly what Subaru does, since he has knowledge of medieval settings. He uses that knowledge to help him figure out where, or the fact that there would be slums somewhere here, and that that's where the thief would have run off to. And this is also where I wrote in my notes about Amelia's cold attitude, which I already addressed, so I don't need to address that again. But that's the end of this chapter. So, episode 3, which is chapter 3, titled The End of the Beginning, which is where we actually get to see shit start going down, we learn about the loot cellar. The loot cellar is basically this place in the slums where presumably stolen goods are taken. It's kind of like a black market. Stolen goods are taken there, and then people can go in there, negotiate prices, etc., sell stuff, buy stuff, whatever, trade things. But upon finding the loot cellar in the slums, this is where we get our first... Holy shit, what the fuck am I reading in this case? Where Subaru enters the loot cellar after nobody comes to the door, and in this pitch black place, using basically like a... It's like a magical rock, I think, that acts as a light, a torch, basically. He comes across an arm. All right. So far, so good. We have an arm on the ground. It looks like a ham bone. And now we come across an armless man. A large man who's armless. We know whose arm that was. This looks really shit. And then out of nowhere, somebody creeps out from the darkness super quick and slashes at Subaru for having to see that. And in this case, Subaru is actually killed, or at least knocked onto the floor. And then Amelia enters the place. Now, Subaru having been knocked out, a man seemingly dead already, And now Amelia, without any warning, comes in. We hear, or I say we hear, but this is me immersing myself in the manga. But we do get to see something happen. There's a loud thud, a slash, and then Amelia just lumps over onto the floor next to Subaru. I remember seeing this in the anime, and my mind was like, holy fucking shit, what the hell did I just see? Because again, remember, I had no idea that this is what I was walking into when I watched ReZero. I didn't expect that type of show at all, and boy am I so fucking glad it is that type of show. This is also where we get, this is where that teaser is from as well, this particular scene where Subaru reaches out for Amelia's hand and basically promises that I will find a way to save you. And this is where he passes out, dies, presumably, and then wakes up again, standing right there, blankly off in the distance, right in the middle of this market street, where he's being told about purchasing an apple, or an apple, or whatever the fuck, right? And this is where you have the revelation, holy shit, he's back in time, or at least he has some sort of ability that he's back in time. Now, like I said before, he doesn't have control over this. He can't just turn back time because he wants to, though you could argue that he can kill himself. In fact, he even does that at points in the story later in order to reset the checkpoint, but he can't do it on a whim. He can't just, you know, Maxine Caulfield herself or himself back a few minutes. So it's not that convenient for him, and he has to suffer. And of course, imagine having to die in a million different ways over and over again. How painful that would be, because that pain doesn't go away. And I don't think people are just going to get used to that type of thing either, just willy-nilly. I'm just cleaning my glasses here because there's a big old smudge on them. So that ends chapter 3 and brings us to chapter 4, where we haven't really hit that part of the story I mentioned earlier yet, where Subaru is kind of having breakdowns and all this shit that they talk about, you know, with other characters being erased and how he has to go through the drama of trying to get over that or trying to figure out a new situation. I'm assuming volume 2 is going to cover that more, because volume 1 does not solve this first encounter yet. But chapter 4, episode 4, The Bitter Taste of Alcohol. Now, Subaru uses his knowledge. Now, he doesn't know for sure that he died. He just knows that something is a bit sussy here because he's basically retracing his steps again. But he pieces it together himself, and so he thinks if he can get a head start and get that thing, that item that was stolen from Amelia back, he can just take it to Amelia and end all of this before anything gets bloody. So he kicks his way through the thugs, no problem. He's not playing around this time. He kicks their asses, kicks them on their ass, and he knows, because this time he knows who has the knife, so he targets them. He knows what the last guy is going to do, and he fucking suplexes this guy. Like, dude, what the hell? You know? Awesome. I mean, that takes some balls to have to put up with those guys. But he makes for the loot cellar, and this is where we meet another character named Rom, who's the big guy that was armless previously. Now, he's totally fine, and he lets Subaru in, even though he doesn't know the password, and they kind of get to talking and chatting. They have a drink together, and this is where Subaru basically kind of convinces Rom or earns his trust a little bit by showing these items from Earth that obviously don't exist in this world, and that gets Rom intrigued because, hey, this stuff looks like it could be really expensive, and some of it's pretty neat. Things like potato chips, or this metia, basically, which is a magical item. Things that are infused with magic in some way to help you do something, I guess, in the world of ReZero, but it's actually a cell phone. And he gets Rom's attention with it by taking a picture and talking about how you can freeze pieces of time in it. Now, that's totally awesome. Even just recently while playing Genshin Impact, I've seen the effect cameras can have on people that don't know what a camera is. And you have to think, how do you explain this to somebody if you've never explained it? Because you and I were born into a world where cameras already existed. So we just grow up knowing what a camera is, and we grow up knowing what a camera does. But how do you actually explain that to someone in another world where cameras don't exist, at least in the traditional sense that we would know it? You know, you can't say, oh, this is a device that takes pictures. You know, what's a picture? How does that work? You know, am I inside this image that you've taken? Or, you know, I don't know. It's just, it's really difficult to try to figure out how you would explain that. But either way, we learn about the badge and that Subaru would like to strike a deal for the badge. Of course, Rom is also pretty interested because he doesn't know how Subaru knows that there's this young girl out there that has stolen an item, you know, and exactly what it is yet. But I guess you could also say that that gives Subaru some sort of leverage by making him look like he's smarter than he really is, because he's actually quite inept in this situation. He doesn't know shit about anything, but having this knowledge before coming into this scenario means he can get the one up on people by basically acting like he already knows everything. So people will take note, he must be pretty important or good at what he does to know that there's someone out there and to know what they look like and to know that they're bringing a stolen item today, you know, etc. But Felt does come into the place and negotiations begin about trying to get a hold of this badge in between the media item, as they call it, or in this case, the cell phone, basically. But we have no sign of Amelia yet. So we haven't seen her. We don't know anything about her in this chapter. She hasn't been brought back for any situation. And this brings us to the last chapter of this book, which is chapter 5, episode 5, A Struggle Far Too Late. Now we learn during the negotiations with Felt that she has been offered 10 blessed gold coins for the badge. Now, a blessed gold coin is actually worth 2 gold coins. So in total, this is 20 gold pieces that she's basically being offered, which is, of course, apparently, from the way that they explain it, extremely, extremely expensive. So to get that kind of money offer for some little trinket is quite big, especially for how easy it was to steal, apparently. But Rom, who is basically kind of inspecting the cell phone, basically says that the cell phone is worth, because he's never seen such a thing, must be worth at least 20 blessed coins, or excuse me, 10 blessed coins, must be worth at least that many, but could be worth way more. And we also learn, though, the reason why Felt doesn't just accept this offer immediately is because she already has a buyer. This is the whole reason why she stole it in the first place. She has a buyer that's coming in later that day who is offering presumably a large amount of money. And so Felt wishes to wait and have a negotiation between all three of them, because what if this buyer is going to offer more money to one-up Subaru, which would mean Subaru would have to one-up them. And that could be a pretty interesting watch. Or in this case, read again. But the buyer does finally arrive, and it is introduced to a new character named Elsa. Now, Elsa may have been visible earlier on in the book, very briefly, her outfit, but here we can see that she's definitely a character of some significance. She's got a very almost elegant design to her, and I can totally hear her voice. See, again, I'm happy I watched the anime before reading this, because even though this would have been so awesome to see even in book form, but I think I'm happy with the fact I started with the anime. But I can hear her voice, just the way she talks. It's so distinct. But anyway, she comes in and sits down, and she does have more money. She doesn't just have 10 blessed coins. She has 20 in total, which means we have a shitload of money on the board here. And since we know that Subaru's phone is at least worth 20 and could be worth more, in the end, Felt basically goes with Subaru's offer, meaning Subaru wins the negotiations, despite the fact that Elsa looks kind of scary, and I wouldn't want to be in a negotiation with her. Actually, maybe, because, well, actually, no. I take that back. Well, maybe. Well, I don't know. I'd have to think about it. Anyways, it's quite interesting just watching this whole scene play out in the book itself. But a question is asked, and unfortunately, Subaru, being the honest boy that he is, actually leads to shit happening. Elsa just throws the question out. She basically just says, well, I guess I've lost this negotiation, you know? Not much I can do about that. But hey, I'm quite curious. What do you want with this little badge anyways? And Subaru just happens to say the words that he shouldn't have said, which is, which is, honestly, I don't want anything to do with it. I don't even know what the fuck it is. I just want to return it to its rightful owner. That's all he says. which leads to Elsa putting on a completely different attitude and saying, oh, so I see, you're one of them. But there's no context given to who one of them are or why she has suddenly gone evil. But this again can help you put together some pieces that, okay, must have something to do with Amelia. And obviously this trinket, this badge, is very important for whatever reason. Again, we will learn about a lot of this stuff later on in the series, but... And then suddenly Elsa whips out a bladed weapon and slashes at Subaru I don't know if it misses him or knocks him back, but he gets knocked onto his ass, and Felt basically wakes him up. Rom grabs his big club. There's this showdown between Rom and Elsa, and now you can see what must have happened before. See, this is what I mean. When you repeat the scenario, it doesn't have to be the same thing over and over again. It's like you get to see it from a different way, and then you get to learn more each time with Subaru, so when he repeats the scenario again, he can try to use the new knowledge to make it go a different way, or try to get everything solved relatively okay. Try to save everybody, basically, is what he's attempting to do. And so, since we get to see this now, because Subaru came here early, we know what happened last time. There must have been something bad that happened that led to Elsa killing them. So this means that even if Subaru didn't say anything and walked off with the trinket, he probably would have been killed by Elsa anyways. Though we didn't get to see a dead Felt, thankfully. I don't need to see that. We don't need to see a dead Felt. We get to see a dead Felt, though. But there's a showdown between Rom and Elsa, and unfortunately, Elsa ends up cutting the guy's arm off, just as we remember seeing his arm before. And during that, he attempts to overwhelm her with a large attack because she just swung her blade, her dagger. There's no way that she'd be ready for another swing, right? Well, shit, no. Yeah, she was ready for it. She's incredibly quick with her attack speed. And unfortunately, Rom ends up getting killed. And this causes Felt to go completely berserk and jump into it, apologizing to Subaru for getting him into this sticky situation. And with a single strike, Felt gets knocked on her ass with a massive slash across her abdomen, which is actually quite surprising to see. I don't get to see her intestines or anything, but it's quite surprising that we get to see that kind of wound in a manga. Even Higurashi doesn't have wounds like that very often shown in its manga. Though you do get the nails in the hand scene, that was quite detailed. And the character with their open stomach. Okay, I guess you do get to see some pretty fucked up shit in Higurashi too, but I don't know, I'm always used to this kind of thing being super heavily censored. And then you have Subaru and Elsa fighting with each other, and unfortunately for Subaru, Elsa has a second bladed weapon, so even though Subaru thought he avoided one of her attacks, she had actually pulled out another weapon and ended up cutting his little belly open. And then she talks very lewdly about how nice his intestines look and the color they have, and I'm sure how warm they are, and I'm sure she'd like to bathe in those intestines. She has some sort of fetish for bowels, which is nice. And that's basically where this chapter ends, with another failure. But we now have a full understanding, just with one volume, we have a full understanding of how Subaru's abilities work and just how that's going to be important to the story moving forward. Because you're going to have, like I said before, you're going to see scenarios like this happen more than once. And we get to see that, as shown in this exact volume, we get to see that the scenario isn't going to always play out the same way. Because we get to learn more, try a new thing, lose, try again. That's what makes his ability not take away from the suspense at all, because characters are really suffering, and Subaru himself is suffering the most for everyone else's sake, and the problem is he can't tell anybody that either, at least not at this point. And I'm very eager to see where this goes next. The afterword is basically just your usual, like, the writer and artists are kind of talking with each other, have their own little paragraph in there, and then there's an image at the end with a character that actually does appear in the book but doesn't have any lines. You don't get to see his face at all. It's Reinhardt that we get to see at the very end, for people that do know about ReZero. We do see him for a very brief moment after Subaru kicks the asses of the thugs and runs off towards the loot cellar after his first rerun, or during his first rerun. We see just some character with a detailed sword crouched over the bodies of the thugs that are now on the ground all knocked out on their ass. But we don't actually get to see him make any other appearance yet. Give it time. I'm sure we will have that experience in Volume 2 of Chapter 1, A Day in the Capital. So I'm very eager to see where this series is going to go in book form. It was a lot of fun to read, just because I love ReZero so much that getting to see it in another form has brought me back into that experience. And even though... What? I have no fucking clue. I thought I just saw something. Even though there are some... Mostly everything is the same as the anime so far, there are some things that were a little bit different or handled a little bit differently or looked differently, and that's always exciting for me to sometimes see, just to kind of see how it goes and how different it looks or feels to me. But overall, I think that's going to bring this one to an end. This was almost an hour long, which is not how my manga coverages really ever go. They're usually 20 minutes or less per volume, but like I said, I wanted to get a lot of the context out of the way here at the very beginning, since this is a long series. There's a lot of ReZero manga books, and they're still actually releasing ReZero manga, so I will cover them as best I can as I own them. Now, right now, I do own, since obviously, like I said, my very first haul, I got a complete chapter 1 and chapter 2, but I also have all volumes for chapter 3 of the manga as well, and I have a couple volumes for chapter 4, so I do have plenty of ReZero manga to read ahead of me, and I am super looking forward to the next arc, the mansion one. That was where I fell in love with ReZero, was during that particular arc, and then the shit that comes after it, which I'm assuming is covered in chapter 3 of the manga, is like, oh, I'm so fucking ready, guys. I am so fucking ready to see this shit, because I love ReZero. Anyways, that's going to bring this to an end. If you have any other manga or anime or visual novels you'd like me to cover in the videos, feel free to suggest them in the comment section down below. Manga, of course, I cover by a volume basis, so it doesn't matter if they're finished, canceled, or still releasing. Shows are a little bit more difficult to cover in that regard, but you can always still suggest everything and I'll throw it on my list if it isn't already there and get to it someday. But other than that, thanks for watching. Feel free to share your own opinions on the ReZero manga down below if you wish, though try to keep spoilers for... Well, then again, I talked a lot about ReZero's future. I usually say try to keep spoilers for the next books out, not only for me, even though I know the story already, but also for other people watching these for their first time. But I guess I already covered it, so I guess you can cover anything you want on ReZero. Though anything post Season 2 Part 2 for me, I have not seen as of the making of this video. Now, there is no Season 3 yet, but I'm just saying that I know the light novel goes beyond as far as I'm aware. So try to keep spoilers of that stuff out if you can, please, because I would love to experience that when the show releases. Thanks for watching, guys. I'll see you in the next Manga Thoughts and Opinions video.